business where we could scale together a lot more easily rather than trying to do it ourselves. The fourth bit is, I feel there's no free money. Entrepreneurs who say, I've got everything, but I need money, most entrepreneurs out who would be here would say, I want third-party money. I don't want to put my money because my savings are for a rainy day. Please remember, if you become an entrepreneur, it's raining. So, don't try and keep your savings for a rainy day because that's what you need.
I think we should tweet that.
And almost invariably, in the early stages, if you take too much third-party money, you'll end up with very little piece of the action yourself, and you'll regret for having,
Given away too much.
And here's the reality in this part of the world. This is not Silicon Valley. Out here, capital is at a premium over enterprise.
Right.
And capital is, and let's not talk about disruptive ideas are generally not existent here. So I won't go there. But just enterprise, because businesses get built on disruption, on enterprise. The perception is if I've got money,
I'm the boss.
Yeah, I can buy enough mudirs and naturs to manage the business. So why should I give a piece of the action? I give you a salary, isn't that great?
Or give you some.
That's your capital tends to undermine enterprise here. So be careful as an entrepreneur if you try and get. How many people in this room are entrepreneurs? Okay, how many of you have raised third-party money? If you raise your hand. Okay. Of the people who raised third-party money, how many are happy at the valuation that you raised your third-party money? Nobody's happy. You're happy?
Sort of.
Your investors in this room or?
No.
Okay.
No.
Okay. Okay.
He's not happy.
Okay. The fourth, I spoke about it, your family is critical to your success. Also get them to understand that, tightening of your belt is inevitable. There has to be some change in lifestyle which you need to go to.
You may not be bringing in money for a while.
There may not be enough bread coming in, and that's all. So you're cutting into your savings, so you need to make sure that the visits to Dubai Mall perhaps need to be tempered a little or whatever.
Let go of that new LV.
Your car, maybe you change the quality of the home, maybe you trade down a little. Fifth, my personal learning is if you're afraid of failing, just don't start, you will fail at times, but that doesn't mean that you will always fail. You'll, from each failing, you learn something and you get started again. The sixth bit is, it's a little hard, and in this current startup, I'm going with that mantra now. Most startups that I've done, I've always shied away from buying professional services of high caliber. Now I'm saying, you want to build a good company, make sure you buy. It's like whether it's branding or it's legal services or it's financial services, it is critical to get it right the first time around.
Right.
Most entrepreneurs tend to say, hey, I can do an agreement. Why do I need to pay lawyers like Keswani 2,200 dirhams an hour? You know what? A contract done wrongly can go and hurt you so badly 5 years down the road that you wouldn't know how to sort it. It's, or branding. Most people say, I don't want to pay for it. Let my product or my service be successful. Then I can always rebrand. The cost of rebranding is huge. Public relations services. Sure. People don't want to, what's it? Big deal. Let me call media. Entrepreneurs tend to invest in hard things. They try and do good-looking offices. You could operate from ServCorp level 41 and still buy Sunil John's PR services, which will make you win the business.
Sure.
But it's, I'm not saying we also have a PR business, but that's, this is the biggest lesson you can learn from His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid. The man is intuitive. I'm sorry I'm calling His Highness. He is truly intuitive. And the instances I've had the good fortune of interacting with him, you know, there are two variables that he's understood. One, which most of us understand, which is material, what the cost is. The second variable, which a lot of us don't understand, which is time. Typically, he would ask, okay, how much do you need and in how much time can you complete a project? Let's say you say, Your Highness, 100 million and 2 years. He would ask normally, would 200 million make it done in a year? It's just instinct. I'm not trying to do a simple arithmetic on that, but that's the way it happens. And you know, a person I admire very deeply, Mr. Muhammad Al-Abbar, I think gave the best definition I have heard to date of Sheikh Mohammed, which is, he's a man who has seen tomorrow. Look at the, you know, a lot of us who've been around in Dubai for a long time, sure, there are lots of things wrong with the place. But show me another city where there's more things right with the place. There isn't one. So we can bitch things, but you know, the reality is that all of us are here out of choice, and we enjoy living here. Just we crib about cost of living, we crib about greedy landlords, we crib about RTA being greedy and whatever, but you know, c'est la vie. As an entrepreneur, be also be prepared to work the longest hours. You've got to be the first in and the last out. If you say, you know what, So you, if you're an entrepreneur and you're a golfer as well, there's a bit of a dichotomous situation there. No matter what you do, don't forget your personal values. I'm a little old-fashioned in that. If you believe that personal gratification is not something that is comfortable, I'm not saying it's good or bad. I'm just saying it's a question of personal choice. I'm not comfortable gratifying an individual personally for a financial gain for myself. If that individual is employed in an organization and not the owner of the organization, it's called a discount.
Right.
So, you know, you can discount your services to even 100% of the way, but then when you give a person who's employed to do a job or to fulfill a function, a certain bit of the action, so that you get more action, in my book, it doesn't work. But then I'm not saying it's wrong, it's a way of looking at it. There are enough business models which work on that, but I'm not comfortable. But as an entrepreneur, if you try and take shortcuts, you will not be able to see yourself in the mirror. I'm just using this as an example, but stick to your values. If you believe that you want to deliver superior education first, and the rest will sort itself out, to hit that particular year's bottom line, don't shortchange.
Sure.
Stick to your values and your principles, and the right things will happen. There's got to be some things that are not negotiable, even if it meant that you don't have money. I'll give you my first, and I think Nitin and Rahul, you are both there. I'll go back to May 1985. We opened Interface on the 1st of May. By the 28th of May, the Indian Sugar Mills Association campaign was done. There was another account called United Nations Fund for Population. And there was a third piece of business that we had picked up in April, which we had taken, called Premier Vinyl Flooring. And we had a lot of hope on that business. Was it 30th May, Rahul or Nitin, do you remember? It was a Saturday afternoon, I think 30th May, 31st May, 29th May. 7th consecutive campaign, corporate campaign at Artworks stage. You're talking 1985, where Artworks costed you money because you were doing phototype setting and what have you, and they were paste-up artists. The technology was very different, cost you a lot of money. 7th stage of Artworks, and the client changed his mind. I said, I can't take this. We resigned the business and came out. And they said, you know, we've got nothing left. I said, whatever, we may have nothing left, but we don't want this shit.
Sure.
So there's a certain thing that you go to, that there's a limit to which you go to, but otherwise they'll keep jerking with you.
Yeah.
So
Sir,
Yeah.
Sorry. Yeah.
And the last bit I would say is make sure you enjoy your ride. As an entrepreneur, you know, just make sure personal learnings that, you know, it's time to change if you're not enjoying what you're doing.
You take this pretty seriously. I mean, just the fact that you've actually written them down. So you live by these rules.
I try and live by some of these. I also don't, at the end of the day, I go by instinct very often. And if it sounds like a pretty nice thing to do, let's do it. And,
Some of our audience would like to ask you some questions.
Sure.
My question to you is, do you or your organization support SMEs or new startups? Is that something you do? Because that's me.
Personally, I feel startups need to look at their immediate ecosystem of trust. It's very difficult otherwise to raise third-party money from people who don't know. Because, as I said, personally, I like to bet on people. So if you LinkedIn request, the Standard Herald, and I think, Poonam and Rahul have pushed it quite often too, my first cars, And I know what pushing is about. I know what startup on that. But, don't over-romanticize that I'm an entrepreneur, there's a startup, and there's, nothing. You've got to have an idea that you believe in, that you think is going to make a difference, that you think is going to be scalable. And that where you have some competitive advantage. The new real estate development company that I'm setting up now, some of the people said, what's wrong with you? There are thousands of those. Well, I believe that, me and my partner believe that there's a differentiated option there and something that we can do something a little differently and still make reasonable returns and not max out. But it's going to be hard. Being an entrepreneur, you've got to be clear as to what you want and why you got into what you're getting into. I don't believe that romanticizing that it's a bad life, I'm an entrepreneur, and feeling very good about it is really a very good thing to do. Be positive, and the car, you'll get a downhill thing where the car will move quite well.
My name is Arif. Good evening, sir. Thank you. Very good discussion you both of you have, in fact. I have a special question related to SME. When SME comes in a growth sector, especially at that time, if you not have a liquidity in your account or cash, at that time you cannot say my SME is going to sustain a certain point of times. So it will go down automatically. At that time, what an entrepreneur should do immediately to sustain his business or towards the high side of the business?
So let me try and understand this right. You're in a sector which is growing very fast. You've got some competitive advantage which is leading you to exploit that, and you're getting more. There's no other option. There are other variables you can play with in terms of supply chain. Try and make sure that you make your supply chain guys, your partners, in some form that, I will pay you, but I'll pay you a little more when I sell, but till then, bear with me. There are some of those hybrid models that you can look at. But I think you're sitting on a positive situation, because you got demand for what you're offering.
See, Dubai has gone through this phase of recession, and a lot of us have had the misfortune of being on the worst side of it, including myself. Now, when do you decide to close a business and maybe start anew? And what is that point when you know that yes, you got to close it and go? And secondly, this is more personal. Do you yourself have any regrets in life?
Regrets in life. On the first question, I think earlier on I spoke about that if you're seeing yourself not enjoying walking into that business every morning, the spring in the air not being there, that's one part of the thing. The second is if month on month your costs are not getting curtailed, your costs are not just getting not getting curtailed, but they're pretty much where they are, and your revenues are sliding month on month, if it happens for 6 months, you are in a problem business. And you need to smell the coffee and say, you know what? It's that old folk song of John Denver, you need to know when to quit, save the rest of the money that you have for a new venture. My personal regret, I regret the fact that I don't know Arabic. I'm honest, and I haven't made efforts. I grew up in a school where I studied 7 languages. Arabic wasn't one of them. And the regret came to life when there was once a meeting with His Highness, where every other person was an Emirati. I was the only non-Emirati, non-Arab Indian. And His Highness said, Bojani doesn't understand Arabic, so we all speak in English.